Dear students, we are in the 14th part of the chapter Elbow Complex of Mechanics, continuing from the 13th part. So the deep pronator quadratus is active during both resisted supination and resisted pronation. So they act also as a dynamic stabilizer to compress the distal radial nerve joint, meaning that because of the two attachments between the two bones distally, radius and ulna, they also act as a dynamic stabilizer during such movements. Supination torque generation was greatest with the forearm in pronated positions, and pronation torque generation was greatest with the forearm in supinated positions. So that means that whenever they did a measure, the torque means the force generation, that is angular force generated by the muscle. Using the study would have done the maybe done with a handheld dynamometer or a EMG study. Both these studies have shown that supination torque maximum was generated when the forearm was positioned in pronation, and pronator torque was generated maximum when the forearm was positioned in supination. So that means that these two muscles were generating their maximum potential in when they were in the other position. The supinator muscle may act alone during unresisted slow supination in all positions of the elbow or forearm. The supinator also can act alone during unresisted fast supination when the elbow is extended. However, activity of the biceps is always evident when the supination is performed against resistance and during fast supination when the elbow is flexed at 90 degree. We all know that the function of the biceps action is both flexion of the elbow as well as the supination. But here we have to understand that the biceps being a supinator, its performance is increases, or the resistance or the torque is generated highly whenever the elbow is in flexion. So that means the supinator muscle acts both whenever this, so whatever may be the position of the elbow or the forearm, supinator muscle can act, but biceps power generation is more during flexion. A mean maximum supination torque of 16 Newton meter was recorded with the forearm at 75% of the total degree of pronation, in comparison with a mean maximum supination torque of 13.1 Newton meter for the neutral forearm position with the elbow at 45 degree of flexion. This is a mere example to show you that whenever the elbow flexion was comparatively, there was no, that is for the in comparison to maximum supination, that means that the flexion of the elbow was affecting the production of torque. That is, the flexion of the elbow is related to the power generation in supinator torque. So 45 degree of elbow flexion, there was what, only 13.1 Newton meter of supination torque. But when this was in pronated, 75% degree of percentage of pronation, the torque was more. So this is to make you understand that flexion of the elbow has a difference to in power generation in the both the biceps as well as in the supinator muscle. Now going to stability, the muscular support of the distal radial nerve joint is attributed to pronator quadratus and the ACU tendon. Now this is again repetition. The last slide we have discussed about the importance of the one joint muscle, pronator quadratus, because of the attachment of the muscle between the two distal bone, that is radius and ulna, the distal end of the forearm bone. So again, this will give stability, we already know that. And also along with that, the extensor carpi ulnaris tendon is also considered as a stabilizer for the distal radial ulnar joint. The extensor carpi radialis brevis also provides support for the forearm, as evidenced by the maximum voluntary effort that is given in short form as MVE in the ECRB that occurs in both supination and pronation torques. So the ECRB, when conducted a study, we could understand that there was maximum voluntary effort of 26% and 43%, while during supination and pronation, the ECRB has a role both in pronation and supination. Pronation, it has a major role, 43% of maximum voluntary effort, and supination, 26% of maximum voluntary effort. The ECRB, that is extensor carpi radialis brevis, appears to act both as a stabilizer to the forearm for gripping during pronation torques, depending on forearm angle, and as a prime mover for wrist extension for supination torques. The ligamentous support, so these, all these factors, even though we have given a lot of, you know, studies, the important thing to remember is the stability factor comes from the radio ulnar comes from the pronator quadratus muscle, ECU tendon, the ECRB, both in pronation and supination, and also again ECRB while acting as a prime mover of wrist extension for supination torque, while supination happening while during extension of the wrist. It has a role both in forearm as well as the primary role as the extensor of the wrist. So we have three muscles which are contributing to stability. And now we will come to the ligamentous support. The ligamentous support of the distal radial ulnar joint is provided by, as we already studied, the dorsal and the palmar radial ulnar ligaments and the interosseous membrane, and its tract and the articular disc provides ligamentous support of the distal radial ulnar joint. We have gone through that earlier elaborately regarding the ligaments and how they affect during the position, orientation of how they orient during pronation and supination, because the dynamically the position, the dorsal ligament comes anteriorly during pronation. And here we also have to think about that the two ligaments, and also we consider interosseous membrane as a ligament, larger ligament, but because of the sheath like presence, we call it as a membrane, and its tract, so it has various tracts. And also the articular disc, which we, if you remember, which is more oriented towards the radius, and also it forms what we call as the triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. So all this together gives stability to the radial ulnar joint. Now I'm showing you this. If you just memorize this, and you can both for your wisdom as well as for the exams. So this is a table I have given so that easy to understand. Ligamentous and muscular contributions to stability at the proximal and distal radial ulnar joints. So we have two joints, which is proximal and radial ulnar joint. We have ligamentous support and muscular support. So proximal radial ulnar joint, the ligamentous support are annular and quadrate ligaments and oblique cord limits supination and interosseous membrane, which we already discussed. And the in the proximal radial of the muscular tension, which we already discussed, is passive tension in the biceps brachii in full extension. Elbow position will affect the passive tension of biceps brachii, and elbow position is a very, very important factor in stabilization of the muscular support. Pronator teres also has a stability factor to play in the proximal radio ulnar joint, because it's a two joint muscle, and it's has a major role to play in the proximal radio ulnar joint. The distal radio ulnar joint, as we already just discussed, interosseous membrane, dorsal radio ulnar ligament. The interosseous membrane, mean you have to understand here, it is a proximal interosseous membrane, and here it is a distal interosseous membrane. So, and also the ligaments are the dorsal radial ulnar ligament and the palmar radial ulnar ligament, the triangular fibrocartilaginous capsule, as you already know. And the muscles include the earlier discussed pronator quadratus, acconius, extensor carpi ulnaris and protractor teres. Anconis, even though the orientation is comparatively proximal, but they have a role to control, stabilize the distal radial nerve by preventing splitting or splaying of the distal end. Even though they are their presence is more proximal and related to the elbow joint, here they do not allow the splaying of distal radial nerve joint. So they, and here again pronator teres has a role even in the distal because it is a long muscle, and but pronator quadratus does not have a role in proximal radial nerve joint. So ECU already we have discussed earlier, and pronator teres also has a muscular role to contribute to stability of the distal radial nerve joint. Now we are coming to the end of the chapter, because we have gone through all the important biomechanical aspects. Now we are entering into the applied the pathology, or what we call as the pathomechanics of the elbow complex. So effects of age and injury are the major things we are going to discuss here. Isokinetic, so effects of aging on elbow muscles, there are a lot of studies have been conducted. So isokinetic means any movement where the speed of the movement is same, similar. Kinetic means here we are talking about velocity or speed of movement. So same velocity, movement with same velocity strength. So this isokinetic is usually, we have a lot of apparatus to maintain the speed of the the apparatus, such as a kind of a device where a movement is possible, but the movement speed will be, can be in a controlled separately. So the person can move only in a definite speed. And there also we can measure the strength of the motion using a dynamometer or using a EMG reading graphically to understand the motor unit activation of the muscle which is being studied. So here we are talking about the elbow muscles of the elbow, all the muscles which we have discussed earlier, the flexor and extensor muscles of the elbow joint, and also including the forearm muscles such as the pronator teres and the quadratus supinator also includes in that. So isokinetic strength losses range from 20% to 30% at slow and fast velocities over a 12 year period, meaning that if somebody has a particular power or torque level, and if you measure the same person's elbow muscles isokinetic strength after 12 years, and the study usually will be conducted in people who are, normal people, not in athletic or any kind of other people who are involved in high athletics, the study will have such conditions. So in a normal condition, every 12 year, what you'll see will be the isokinetic of strength of the elbow muscle will deteriorate from 20 to 30%. Isokinetic strength in the elbow flexors and extensors declined by 2% per decade for women, and by 12% per decade for every 10 years. The elbow flexors and extensors, that is the biceps and the brachialis and the brachioradialis, and extensor, which is the triceps and the minor anguinius, these muscles have been proven to every 10 year after, when the aging starts, the persons, if it is female, it is comparatively lesser. The female's muscle strength does not reduce. Compared to males, it is reducing too much, 12% per 10 years. Muscle quality, that which is peak torque per unit of muscle mass. Sorry. For concentric peak torques, showed a 28% decrease in men and a 20% decrease in women. Here everywhere, if when you see the male's muscle quality, even we all know that the muscle power of men are comparatively more than the women. But during aging, the weakness happens more for the men. Here also you can see that the muscle quality also is decreasing, 28% in men and only 20% in women. Eccentric peak torque showed a 25% decline in men, but the decline, if you talking about the eccentric contraction peak torque, for men it is 25% decreasing every decade, and but not at all decreasing for women. So here the women are